the Detroit Lions, arguably one of the lesser teams in NFL history. They've existed since 1930, but have never made it to a Super Bowl. Not only have they not made it to a Super Bowl, but they only have one playoff win in the Super Bowl era. That is not a good track record for a team that's been in the league for that long. The Lions have a history of futility that goes beyond their lack of success in the postseason. And there's some strange and odd history about the team. They hold the not-so-good record of being the only team in NFL history to be 0-16 and doing so in 2008. Another sign of a poorly ran franchise is when star players retire when they're still in their prime, rather than continuing to play for the team. This was the case for Hall of Fame running back Barry Sanders, who had abruptly called quits prior to the 1999 season at the age of just 31. And Sanders isn't the only Lions star to retire in his prime. More recently, wide receiver Calvin Johnson did the same thing when he called it quits in the 2015 season when he was just 30 and only played 9 years in the NFL. The Lions had high draft picks, which they used on busts like Joey Harrington, passing on future Hall of Famers like Andre Johnson and Ben Roethlisberger. Then, there's a lack of playoff victories. The Lions have gone more than 10,000 days since the last time they won a playoff game, way back in 1992. With the transition from Martha Ford to her daughter Sheila Ford Hamp as the principal owner of the Detroit Lions, it's time to look at the strange and oftentimes miserable history of the team's franchise. Now, this isn't no shade at all, this is just looking at the strange history. The first owner was George Richards, who purchased the fledgling Portsmouth Spartans and relocated the team to Detroit. Richards owned the powerful WJR radio station and bought the team in the spring of 1934. He spent just under $23,000 to purchase the team and cover some of the outstanding debts before relocating to Detroit. Unlike a lot of previous Detroit pro football teams, the new Lions team was loaded with some of the finest players of that era, and the first team leader was Dutch Clark, and he was a true triple threat superstar, and the last NFL drop kicker who became a charter member of the Pro Football Hall of Fame. In their inaugural season in Detroit several months later, the Lions started off with a 10-game win streak that included 7 shutouts. However, they lost the last 3 games of the season to the Green Bay Packers, Chicago Bears, and finished in second place behind the Bears in the Western Division, once again coming up short to their rivals. That same year, Richards negotiated an agreement with NBC to carry his Thanksgiving games live across all the nation's network-affiliated stations. So that's why decades and decades later, when you eat turkey or fixing up the turkey, you see them on TV. The Lions advanced to the 1935 NFL Championship game against the New York Giants, and they won the game 26-7 to secure the first world championship for the franchise, which was also a part of Detroit City's of champions for the 1935 and 1936 sports season. The Detroit Tigers won the 1935 World Series, while the Detroit Red Wings captured the 1936 Stanley Cup. Those early successes firmly established pro football in Detroit, and for more than 60 years, the sport has been an integral part of the Michigan sports scene. Richards owned the team until 1940, when he sold to Chicago department store magnate Fred Mandel. The sale price was recorded at $225,000, and that included no stadium at all. The Lions played at Briggs Stadium, the home of the Tigers, beginning in 1937. After falling one game short of the Packers in 1938 with a 7-4 record, the team's aces Dutch Clark and Ernie Cadell retired. Like, what? In 1939, the Lions' first year without their superstar players, they only managed to get a 6-5 record. This would set the tone for the next decade, as the 1940s saw the Lions only win 35 games in the whole decade. The low point is when they went 0-11 in 1942. The 1942 team was so bad that they only scored 5 touchdowns all season, were shut out 5 times, and never scored more than 7 points in a single game. With the first overall pick in the 1943 NFL draft, the Lions drafted Frank Sinkwich from Georgia. The Lions would finish the 1943 season with a 3-6-1 record. A notable occurrence happened during that season on November 7th when the Lions and the New York Giants played in a scoreless tie. I don't think we'll ever see that again on NFL or college or any level. 0-0? Nah. And that was the last time the NFL game ever had an endless score. In 1944, Sinkwich won the NFL's Most Valuable Player Award after leading the Lions from a 1-3-1 start to a 6-3-1 finish. This was the team's first winning record since 1939. The team was then sold after the 1947 season, following an expensive buyout of coach Gus Doré. A cooperative ownership group, including electrical products company executive D. Lyle Fife and Edwin Anderson, the owner of the local Goebbels Brewery, took over the team for $165,000. At the start of the 1950s, the Lions had a roster to compete for some championships, but they were still in need of a franchise quarterback. To solve this, they traded fullback Camp Wilson to the New York Yanks in exchange for quarterback Bobby Lane. After finishing a disappointing 6-6 season in 1950, head coach Bob McMillan resigned and he was replaced by Buddy Parker, who had previously played for the Lions in the mid-1930s, including being part of the 1935 championship team. The following season saw the Lions improve with a 7-4-1 record. In 1952, the Lions finished with a 9-3 record, tied with the Los Angeles Rams for first in the NFL's National Conference. Thus, for the first time in 17 years, the team returned to the playoffs. In the National Conference playoff, the Lions defeated the Rams 31-21 in front of nearly 50,000 spectators at Briggs Stadium in Detroit, playing in fog. The win sent the Lions back to the NFL championship game against the Cleveland Browns, which was the first of four championship games the two teams would play against each other during the decade. The Lions defeated the Browns by a score of 17-7 to win their second title in franchise history. The next year saw the Lions enjoy one of the greatest seasons in franchise history too. They would draft future Hall of Fame linebacker Joe Schmidt in the 7th round of the 1953 NFL Draft. The Lions went 10-2, which was good for first place in the renamed Western Conference. In addition, the team had 7 Pro Bowlers, 8 All-Pros, and swept their division rivals Chicago and Green Bay in 4 consecutive weeks. The Lions faced the Browns again in the 1953 NFL Championship game, in which Lane found Jim Doran for a 33-yard game-winning touchdown in the final minutes to win 17-16. In 1954, the Lions would finish with a 9-2-1 record and face the Browns in the NFL Championship game for the 3rd consecutive season. This time, though, the Browns destroyed the Lions 56-10, ruining their shot at a three-peat. William Clay Ford purchased minority shares in the franchise in 1961 and also assumed the team presidential role. Anderson took over as GM the same year as Ford quickly took a more prominent role. Ford became the sole owner on November 22, 1963, the same day President John F. Kennedy was shot in Dallas. Anderson and Fife were sparring over power of the team amidst a gambling scandal that cost the team hefty fines and star DT Alex Karras to a year-long suspension. Ford bought out all the other minority owners for $4.5 million and assumed control as principal owner. Ford officially bought out Fife in early 1964, while Anderson remained as the team's GM throughout the 1966 season. He remained the team's sole owner for more than 50 years until he passed away on March 9, 2014, at age 89. In the mid-1960s, the Lions served as the backdrop for the sports literature of Georgia Plimpton, who spent the time in the Lions training camp masquerading as a player. This was the basic material for his book Paper Lion, later made into a movie starring Alan Alda, plus a number of actual Lions players including Alex Karras. During Ford's ownership tenure, which extended to his death in 2014, the Lions won just a single playoff game. With the AFL and NFL merging, the Lions were placed in a new NFC Central division with the Chicago Bears, Green Bay Packers, and Minnesota Vikings. Motown soul singer Marvin Gaye made plans after the death of duet partner Tammy Terrell to join the Lions and go into football. He gained some serious weight and trained for his tryout in 1970, but he was cut early on. He remained friends with a number of players, particularly Mel Farr and Lem Barney, who appear as background vocalists on his 1971 classic single, What's Going On? Since their last title in 1957, the Lions have been looking in vain for that top spot. While outstanding players such as Joe Schmidt, Yale Larry, Lem Barney, Dick Night Train Lane earned election to the Pro Football Hall of Fame, the best the Lions were able to accomplish as a team for the next two decades were two wildcard berths in 1970 and 1982. The Lions finally ended their long championship drought by winning the NFC Central Division Championship in 1983. The Lions, under coach Wayne Fonts and paced by Hall of Fame running back Barry Sanders, the team's all-time rushing leader, also won division titles in 1991 and 1993. Detroit's first playoff victory since 1957 took the Lions all the way to 1991 NFC Championship game. However, in the NFC Championship game, they were once again completely overpowered by the Redskins, and this time the score was 41-10. The Lions' strange history of misery continued into the new millennium as they went the entire 2001, 2002, and 2003 seasons without a victory on the road. This streak, it was an NFL record 24 games, but it came to an end on September 12, 2004 when they beat the Bears 20-16 at Soldier Field in Chicago. Hoping to bounce back from 2007, 2008 came and they had their heads up as they were 4-0 during the preseason. But once the regular season took off, well, they hit rock bottom. After starting 0-3, Matt Millen was fired as team president and CEO. Over 7 seasons under his leadership as team president, the Lions owned the NFL's worst winning percentage, never had a winning season, never finished higher than 3rd place in the NFC North. Tom Lawan was appointed team president, while assistant general manager Martin Mayhew was promoted to general manager. The Lions never recovered and had the worst season in NFL history, 0-16. That's until the Browns matched that in 2017. The Lions were the first team to go winless since the 1982 Baltimore Colts went 0-8-1 in the strike-shortened season and the first in a non-strike season since the 1976 expansion Tampa Bay Buccaneers. The Lions' 16 straight losses in 2008 also broke the record for most consecutive losses in a single season, previously held by the 2001 Carolina Panthers, who had lost 15 straight. William Ford's wife of 67 years, Martha, got control of the team following her husband's death. On June 23, 2020, the Ford's second oldest child, Sheila, took over from her mother as principal owner and chairwoman. Her first major move after taking over as principal owner of the Lions was to fire GM Bob Quinn along with head coach Matt Patricia. That was after the Lions had a 4-7 start to the 2020 season. It still remains a mystery. Why have the Lions had all these different bad eras? Well, will they ever get up there? Will it ever improve? Please give us a thumbs up, subscribe to the Sports Plug Nation if you aren't already, and as always, thank you for watching.